Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for coming along this morning to our first, or this afternoon, I should even say at this stage, to our very first Get RHA Aware online webinar. The Get RHA Aware campaign is a brand new campaign for us, and it's designed to, I guess, raise awareness for rare diseases, particularly raising awareness with our elected representatives to ensure that they're pushing for the types of resources that we as a community feel that we need in order to improve care for people living with rare diseases. I'm Vicky McGran, I'm the Chief Executive of Rare Diseases Ireland. Before I go any further, I know that there's a number of people that are signed into the meeting. If you want to just share who you are and where you're coming from, particularly for any of our elected representatives, that would be tremendously helpful. There's also a Q&A function, so if anybody has any questions or comments, and I'll try and come back to those over the course of the meeting. I will be joined at this meeting by Dr. Rachel Crowley from St. Vincent's Hospital. She's an consultant endocrinologist there, and Laura Egan, a mother to Alana, who's living with a rare disease. But I will let them discuss their pieces when in due course. Very quickly, before we get into talking with Laura and Rachel, I just wanted to give you a little bit of background on what we will call the diagnostic odyssey for people living with rare diseases. So there's been considerable research done over the last year or two, both by Rare Diseases Ireland and by Eurordis Rare Diseases Europe, on the diagnostic odyssey for people living with rare diseases in Ireland. Recent research has shown that it's taking on average 6.1 years to achieve a diagnosis, and 37% of people living with a rare disease have spent over 5 years trying to get a diagnosis. So that's a long journey between your first symptoms and actually achieving that diagnosis. For some people, they can get a diagnosis at birth through newborn screening, but obviously for others, it's a very long journey. Some of this might be driven by the availability of the science behind achieving a root cause diagnosis for something. But for many, it's just an arduous process, I guess one could say. Typically during the diagnostic journey, 73% of people are seeing three or more consultants, and 53% are assessed or treated for three or more different conditions. So you can see that there's a lot of, misdiagnosis happening. There's a lot of people sitting on waiting lists right across the healthcare system. And we do feel that if we could achieve a quicker diagnosis, that we should be able to reduce some of the burden, not alone on families living with rare diseases, but for practitioners in the healthcare space as well, that achieving a rapid diagnosis or a speedier diagnosis will relieve the healthcare system generally of some of the burden that's currently on it for people living with rare diseases. Just in terms of those that are living with rare diseases, 49% have indicated that they've received inappropriate care, treatment or surgery. And some of this can be harmful as well to the people. So that's a large number of people that are receiving inappropriate medicines or undergoing inappropriate therapies of some description. 62% have said that they've, because of the diagnostic journey, that they've actually had delayed access to the correct types of treatment. And 66%, so that's two thirds, are saying that their symptoms are worsening while they're on that diagnostic journey. Finally, in terms of the diagnostic journey, as many of you will know, rare diseases are particularly impactful on families with young children. Many of them appear in childhood. And during this time, while people are trying to seek the diagnosis for their child, they may be thinking about having further children, and it's very difficult to access appropriate, guidance and counselling in terms of should they have more children or what should they do? Are there things that they should be doing to avoid maybe passing on further genetic conditions? So without further ado, I would like to welcome Rachel. Dr. Crowley is a consultant endocrinologist at St. Vincent's University Hospital. She's also a clinical lead for one of the new European reference networks that Ireland has recently joined up to, and is also a clinical lead on the Rare Disease Clinical Trials Network. Rachel is obviously a busy person, and we'd like to thank her very much for making herself available today and giving a little bit of her experience as a practicing doctor in terms of achieving a diagnosis for her patients. Rachel?
Thanks very much for the introduction, Vicky, and the opportunity to talk to your audience today. So I suppose I'm a consultant endocrinologist in practice, and that means that I am a doctor for hormones. And there are lots of rare diseases of hormonal conditions that affect lots of patients in Ireland. So we're used to seeing people living with rare disease. And because we look after so much rare disease, we spend a lot of time going to conferences and reading and trying to keep up our practice. And we were increasingly aware as a specialty of the need to do genetic testing on patients with certain patterns of hormonal conditions. And at the time when I became a consultant, there wasn't a resource to look after adult patients with rare diseases that might have a genetic component. It was pretty limited to pediatric patients, and our patients were all 16 years and older in St. Vincent's. So I started looking into how I was going to get genetic diagnoses for these people that we suspected might have a heritable condition. And through tapping into international connections and talking to conference speakers after their talks, we identified the labs in the UK that would do the tests, and our lab in Vincent's were very decent about this and supported us to send off. And we started to send testing on patients and getting these results back. And that sounds great, but it's pretty limited, because back in the day, we didn't get training when I was a trainee in this. And it's fine when you get a result that you go, oh, I know exactly what to do with that result now. That is in a guideline, that's in the literature. It's different when you get something that is perhaps more complex from a genetic analysis point of view, or when there's a new finding where there isn't a guidance about how you're going to follow up this patient in the long term. So for the doctor working in this, that's very lonely, trying to find out what your support network is to get more information. And for the patient and the family, this is a really difficult time. It's a difficult time waiting to get to see us, then waiting for the test result back, then getting any test result where there is a bit of ambiguity is a really difficult thing for them. And then perhaps potentially going into a surveillance program with what could in endocrinology be scans, blood and urine tests, camera tests, looking for other things that we know are associated with this gene variation, but that mightn't be the actual problem that the patient came to you with in the first place. And then what you do with families. So it's very fortunate that one of the geneticists in Crumlin who noted that we were looking after people said, you know, if you find something in one of your patients, I'll help you do the work for their family of doing the surveillance and the genetic testing. And we were really well supported by her to do that. But it's still an imperfect system, even though we've worked out this way to deal with it. It's come into practice internationally to do it the way I'm describing. There's an NHS genomics test directory now that says if you're an endocrinologist, you know, you are empowered to test patients with these conditions for these disorders. And you don't have to go through a waiting list of referring your patient to a genetics team. But I think I still need a support network around me and my patients that will help us do this the best possible way, to give them an answer quickly, to interpret any complicated results, to have somebody they can go to when they're talking about what to do with their family members, to have somebody to come back to in later life if they're, you know, planning fertility and families, and what are they going to do with that information they know about their diagnosis. If they don't find something in the first test, how are they going to be communicated with if a new gene variation is found in time that could potentially explain their condition? How do we contact them? There are all of these things that, as a health service and a country, we need to work together to improve.
Thank you very much, Rachel. Laura, I might ask you to come in now. Again, as I say, there are questions. There's a Q&A box if anybody would like to ask any questions. But Laura, would you like to tell us a little bit about your diagnostic journey with your daughter, Alana? What age is she now?
Alana is 22.
She's 22. Okay. Yeah. And when did she get a diagnosis?
She was diagnosed just before she turned 11, a couple of months before she turned 11.
Tell us a little bit about that diagnostic journey for you and for your family.
It was quite long, but 22 years ago, we didn't have the advances in genetic medicine as what we have now. She presented with global developmental delay. She was failure to thrive. She had one thing after another.
And how was that for your family? She received treatment relatively quickly, or she was observed from an early age, you said earlier?
She was observed more or less from the time she was born because she was failure to thrive. Alana only weighed 9.4 pounds when she was 8 months old. So her weight, she was 5.4 pounds when she was born, so her weight gain was very, very slow. That was monitored very closely. So because that was monitored so closely, the doctors and therapists that we were involved with were very quick to pick up the milestones that she was missing.
Okay, so you kind of got early access to the treatment. And what was it like for you? You were a young new mother at that stage. What was it like for you?
It was lonely. We had no social media, so there was nobody really to reach out to at the time when she was, I suppose, at the worst stage of our journey. You know, there's the blame game as well, where you relive your pregnancy and you're kind of thinking, did I do this? Should I have done something different? There was also one clinician in particular who blamed my parenting on her missing milestones and actually asked us to keep an interaction diary to show her how much we're interacting with our child. So that was tough.
Definitely. And so then when you achieved the diagnosis, then what did that open up for you? What did that mean for you as a family and for your daughter, Alana?
When we achieved the diagnosis, I suppose there was that relief as well that it wasn't something that I had done. We had social media. She was diagnosed early 2011. So we did have social media. So that allowed us to reach out to different Coolin de Vries families around the world. We made several trips to the UK in the first 2 years after she was diagnosed, and we met up with people of all ages who had a diagnosis of Coolin de Vries syndrome. You know, so to see, we've seen a lot of people who were young adults, and to see how happy they were and how they were embracing their condition, it was quite comforting for us. It also gave us an insight into, I suppose, how her future can be impacted. There's quite a few health issues that are associated with Coolin de Vries syndrome. And thankfully, at the moment, she doesn't have any, but there are quite a few quite serious health issues that can seriously impact their health and limit their life in some situations.
Okay, very good. But Alana's doing well now, yes?
Alana's doing great. Her biggest issue would be her anxiety. She's quite anxious, but we're managing that. She's so happy. You'll never meet anybody as happy as her. She loves life. She loves everything she's doing. She's very aware of her restrictions. She's very aware of what she's able to do, what she's not able to do, and things she's not going to be able to do in the future. Like, she knows she'll never live independently, but she's very happy. She embraces it all.
Very, very good. So tell us then, while you were still on the diagnostic odyssey with Alana, you went ahead and had some had further children. How was that?
I suppose if there was more emphasis on the fact that this could be a genetic condition, we probably would have decided to not have more children until we got a diagnosis for Alana. She was 8 when my second daughter was born. So I was constantly watching for signs that there might be something wrong with her. I probably didn't enjoy her as much as I should have enjoyed her. I was kind of, you know, pushing her to do things so that, you know, I could help her to develop, even though she's fine. She had no developmental issues whatsoever.
You were eagle-eyed.
Sorry?
You were eagle-eyed.
I was, very. And I was with my son as well, even though Alana was diagnosed when he was 2 months old. And we knew it was Alana's case was de novo, which means that it started in her. But I remained kind of eagle-eyed about everything. I still am.
Well, I think that's natural for all parents. So tell us a little bit then, Laura, when you got Alana's diagnosis, you had to wait a period of time to actually get access to a genetic consultant to discuss this diagnosis. What did you do in that time period? How long was it?
We were the lucky ones who only had about 6 months to wait to see a genetic counsellor. Most people are waiting up to 2 years. I can't imagine if we had to wait 2 years. I did a certain amount of reaching out to different people and getting proper information from different parents who were raising children like Alana. But I did hit Google as well. And I got the worst case scenario. You know, I got things came up that have never affected Alana. But of course, you know, it was scary. Some of the stuff that I read was it was scary. It just, you know, you get worst case scenario when you hit Dr. Google.
Absolutely. There's a lot of benefits from Dr. Google, but sometimes I'm wondering.
Yeah. Yeah.
I see a question coming in here now. Thank you very much, Laura, for your input there, from Andy McLaughlin, who this might be a question maybe directed towards Rachel, really. So I'm curious to what extent the value of receiving a diagnosis is dependent on the availability of treatment. Are treatments available for most people with rare diseases? And in the remainder of instances, what is the value of a diagnosis? So I think actually, Rachel and Laura, you could both speak to different pieces of that. But Rachel, maybe we'd start with you. You know, do you seek a diagnosis more for where there is a known treatment? Or is this is just part of your medical practice that you just do it for all your patients as you can?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I think generally, we're trying to establish a diagnosis, and there are lots of reasons for that. There are lots of potential benefits to having a diagnosis that aren't to do with a disease-specific treatment at the other end. Actually, with rare diseases, only a tiny fraction have an associated disease-specific treatment. You know, less than 1 in 10 rare diseases has an actual treatment associated with it. But that doesn't mean that you can't do something for the patient and for their family living with the rare disease. And it's helpful to get it. I mean, Laura's just mentioned that it taps you into support networks for people with the same diagnosis, or that you can predict perhaps something that might happen in the future that could be headed off at the pass if you know what's going on. The flip side is there are certain circumstances where getting a diagnosis gives you access to a treatment. And a concrete example of that is in my rare bone clinic, we do genetic testing for a condition called X-linked hypophosphatemia. So people basically pass a lot of phosphate in their urine and it gives them a genetic form of rickets. They get these softening of the bone changes. And now for children and adolescents with this disorder, it's reimbursed to get a specific treatment called burosumab from the Irish healthcare system that will improve final height for children living with this, healing of any fractures that they have, prevent their legs bowing as you would expect with rickets. So doing the genetic test actually has given those people access to a treatment.
Thank you, Rachel. Laura, any thoughts on the value of a diagnosis from your perspective, or as Rachel covered it there, the networking, the peer-to-peer support?
Yeah, the networking, parent-to-parent support is invaluable when you have a child with a rare disease. When we were diagnosed, there was nothing really in Ireland, but we did have a Cool and DeFreeze network across the world, which was fantastic. But like Rachel said, the health conditions associated with it, like melanoma is one of the things that's associated with Cool and DeFreeze syndrome. So it made us aware to be looking for different changes in her skin, you know, examining her body for moles, which we continue to do. So for the health side of things, even more so than like the family support is important, but for the health side of things, it is quite important to have that diagnosis.
Dare I say it, you're possibly even more of an expert than Alana's medical professional carers at the moment, because you're living it. So you're checking this on a daily and a weekly basis, and you're keeping up to date. You're hearing what other families are going through, and you're trying to make sure to cut it off as the past, as Rachel has said. I see a comment coming in here from Sally Ann Lynch. You won't know if there is a treatment or not until you make a diagnosis. So it really, you have to have the diagnosis before you can determine whether or not there is an available treatment. So we try and, I guess, get a diagnosis for everything. Making a diagnosis makes such a difference in accurate recurrence risk, allowing people to link in with families and same. Never underestimate the power of a diagnosis. And I think that does come across very clearly with people that we speak with living with rare diseases, that the undiagnosed journey is just so difficult. And while a diagnosis doesn't necessarily mean that's the end, or, you know, there's not lots of worries that come with it, but it's the first step on the journey. It's the first concrete step that, well, at least I know now what might be coming in the future. Okay, so I have a question here from Catherine Lawler. My question is, if a variant of uncertain significance is found on a gene, but it's extremely rare and there's no known literature, is this in this variant, how long do you have to wait until you can get answers? Rachel, I think that's the how long is a piece of string question.
Oh, yeah, that's really hard. And again, I must say, I am not a clinical geneticist, and I don't pretend to be. The VUS is these situations where you don't know. These are the areas where I would really love to have for my patients more support. This is what the new program of support care in genomics medicine Ireland should be trying to do, is how do we manage that? So there are loads of investigations that are at a research level that genomics researchers do to try and figure out, is one of these variants significant clinically or not? And it takes a long time to work that out. And the more rare the condition is, the less likely there is to be, you know, a group of patients internationally that you can tap in and their families to figure this out. I mean, I know from experience that there was a family that we got this type of report back in 2015, and we were asked, could we do a very complicated hormonal test where actually the drug was not available, even though we explored it. And we talked to the family, and it was effectively parked, as is being described here in this question, for a while. And now the lab has gotten back onto us later on and said, actually, we're seeing more and more reports of this test result coming back up, and we may be able to do more now than we told you back in 2015. So it does take a huge amount of time. I think it doesn't take away from looking after the patient and what's going on with that individual clinically, and trying to say, what are the problems now? Are there things we can address? If this gene variant is proven to be clinically a problem, what might that look like? What else might happen? You can think about all of those things, but not start screening out among the family and doing all the standard, you know, genetic counseling advice. That's very difficult to do with the VUS. I mean, if Sally Ann is in the Q&A, she might like to go in the chat and give a much more nuanced genetics response to it. But I don't want to put Sally Ann on the spot, since she didn't have to come on and say anything with this today.
Thank you, Rachel. For those who aren't aware, Sally Ann is one of our clinical geneticists in the country, one of the handful that we have, and does a great job for the rare disease community. She's much loved by those who do interact with her. Oh, and I see a big long response from Sally Ann is actually in there. Well done, Sally Ann, preempting that. Patricia Toey from the Huntington Disease Association. Thank you, Laura and Rachel, for your insightful discussion. Without a diagnosis, families experience isolation and frustration. In addition to resources, we need more education and general services so that people are referred correctly. And I think that again is, I guess, yeah, it's something that we see a lot, that I think, as Rachel has said there, and Rachel, she might not describe herself as a spring chicken, she is still pretty young, I would hazard a guess, and still she would say that her own experience of the education system didn't give her a lot of these tools, and therefore we do need to really revisit how our clinicians and healthcare providers are being educated, what they're being provided, what information they're being provided with, and how we're going to do it on an ongoing basis for people. And I know that is a big challenge, not just here in Ireland, but internationally. But it is very definitely part of the challenge for all of us. Rachel, I had a question for you. I know that you have taken an active interest in your specialism in this area for your education and for upskilling yourself. But I wonder, just, do you have any kind of feeling maybe in different specialisms or different, I guess, endocrinologists around the country? I mean, like, is if a patient sees you, they might get access to genetics. Do you think that that's happening with patients that are seeing other consultants across the country? Or do you think that there's probably, dare I say it, inequitable? It's not a level playing field, because it really just depends upon who you're with.
So there are plenty of endocrinologists who are following a practice something similar to what I described at the beginning of this, but not everybody. And that's just a function, as you've already said, of how we're trained or how our training has looked until now. This idea that the genetic test done on the patient who is affected by the disease would be ordered by the specialty that managed that disease is a relatively new concept. So it wasn't part of training to do that. The European reference networks and the opening of these lead centres in Ireland should signpost centres that are used to this and that would be able to plug patients into getting this testing and their families faster than previously. That's not just a help to patients and their families, that's a help to other doctors working around the country to find a colleague that might know what to do or at least might know where to start. Because sometimes we don't know what the disease condition is, and we literally go to international meetings and start talking to people and saying, you know, I've got this case. Or we ask the patient's permission and we publish a case report, and we're found, as has happened to me in the past, by a company that's interested in a treatment, or another researcher who said, we're trying to collect this group of patients together to find out more, or a patient advocate group that wants to get people together to find out more. So yeah, people have different experiences going to different centres. And the goal of any national programme, not just in genomics, but in rare disease, should be to make it as even as possible across the country. And even just to signpost where the expertise is, that's really key for doctors, for other healthcare professionals, for the patient, for their families.
Thank you very much, Rachel. I see a question has come in here from Declan Mina, who I know is from Fighting Blindness. And he makes the observation, for people with rare genetic eye conditions, a genetic diagnosis allows access to clinical trials. And that clearly, Rachel, from your own background in terms of the Rare Disease Clinical Trial Network, would be something that would be close to your own heart. What's your feeling? Is genetics the route into, do you think, clinical trials generally speaking, or is it a prerequisite, I guess, that if we had a genetic diagnosis, it'll give people, because we recognize particularly in the cancer space, that where we have a good clinical trials infrastructure, that the outcomes for people living with cancer here in Ireland are much better, because people are constantly pursuing new trials and stuff, and we'd like to see the same type of pursuit for people living with rare diseases as well.
Yeah, so that's what we're trying to do with the Rare Disease Clinical Trial Network. Myself and Cormac McCarthy, who's also based in UCD, is to try and bring more clinical trial activity to Ireland. So a trial is just a way of testing if some type of intervention improves care or survival or quality of life for patients living with that disease. And everybody thinks of that as being a drug. You know, a drug versus another drug that's already out there, or a drug versus a sugar pill that doesn't do anything active. But trials are much broader than that. So as Declan was just saying there, it could be a gene therapy. It could be a support intervention. So even if, like Laura was saying, there's no direct treatment for the disease, perhaps helping people with, you know, counseling might be an intervention that could support people. There's lots of ways that we could make the lives of people living with rare disease better. So genetics as a way of getting into them, it certainly makes people identifiable, because if you think about it, then there is a lab somewhere that has, you know, the information that 60 people from Ireland have tested positive for this gene and are out there. That's one way that makes them findable. In your clinic, you have a confirmed diagnosis when it's a known gene. Now, I'm not talking about the VUS as we were talking about earlier. And because theoretically, people with the same variant in a gene theoretically may have a similar clinical course, it's attractive to people designing a trial to try and put all those people into one and see how it changes. Now, that's not true for every gene variant. There's lots of examples I could give in hormonal conditions where not, you know, it's different even across family members of how this condition can show up. But that's certainly in trials that I've been involved with, having a positive gene test result was an inclusion criterion for the trials that looked at burosumab that I mentioned there. And I know it was upsetting for patients who were excluded when their gene test came back negative that they couldn't get onto the trial. I've just been involved with another study where they looked for a gene in a bone condition that's much more common, but in families is much more rare. And they showed that the disease course is different in people who have this gene mutation, and maybe giving a medication early can prevent people getting all the complications of this bone condition later on. So I think it's as Sally Ann said, it's getting a diagnosis opens up worlds of other opportunities. And even if you don't get into a trial, if your care is taking place in a hospital or an institution where trials are conducted, the quality of care has been proven internationally to be higher. So getting patients into trials, getting them into centres where trials are done, that's really important for just making this health service better for everybody.
Thank you, Rachel. Just another couple of minutes before we'll wrap up. I guess the aim of this campaign is to try and get more resources initially placed at Crumlin Genetics, as that's kind of the referral centre for many people with rare diseases. And the role that we have spoken about is around a new role that's been identified also as part of the strategy, the genomics resource associate. And that being somebody that can help with some of the triage process, and somebody that can help, you know, once a diagnosis has been made, to point people in the direction in terms of other care and making sure that they're fed into the right pathways and stuff like that. Just Laura, from your perspective, I know it's a number of years now since you went through this process, but do you think that a resource like that would have been useful to you at the time, that there might have been somebody at the end of a phone? Would it have helped you?
It would have helped to have somebody at the end of the phone. There's very little follow-up when you are diagnosed. There's very little follow-up. It's just a matter of managing symptoms and, you know, providing the therapies. So having somebody, if you had a question, having somebody to a key person as such that you could call, I think it would.
Yeah.
It was quite a long time ago.
Sadly, as we know, that the waits for people have only extended since your time. So,
for people with smaller children, I think this would. I definitely think that this would be helpful for people with smaller children.
Yeah.
have a key person that they can call, even to help with therapies. Therapies are very scarce nowadays as well. So even if there was somebody that they could link in with in genetics to help out with getting them the therapies that they're going to need to help their children reach their potential from a young age.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Laura. Rachel, any thoughts on this new potential role? What would you like to see your patients getting access to if you were referring them into Crumlin? I know it's a little bit different in terms of lots of yours or your patients are generally adults, and maybe it's family members that might have children, but it is still the main centre even for any type of referral of any description, I guess.
Well, I think at a very basic level, it's helpful if there's somebody there who can say it's going to take you this length of time to get to see your counsellor. It's going to take this length of time for the test to come back. You know, these are the ways that we can let you know what the test is. This is who you contact for support. You know, signposting the centres where somebody has expertise in the condition, or even in the ultra rare disorders where somebody has expertise in similar conditions, where we do have patients attending us who are the only person in Ireland who has that diagnosis, or who have a particular pattern where nobody else has described it in the world. That's not that unusual. And as we keep saying, a rare disease in itself is rare, but to have a rare disease is actually common. So it's important to flag all of that. I mean, there is this concept that if there was a genomics resource associate post in place, that people who had gotten the diagnosis could come back in other life phases to use this as a resource. So, for example, if one of the small children that Laura's describing has a diagnosis and that's communicated, you know, to their family by a doctor, but that boy or girl grows up and is planning a family of their own and wants to know what's the situation for family planning, what are their options, what are the odds, that they can go back and tap in and reopen a discussion. As Laura said, seek follow-up where that result is on the record. As Sally Ann said in the chat, often if people have been sending results to different labs, you know, there's a sort of a disconnect and nobody can go back and find out where did this come from 20 years ago when somebody's going back for more information. Having everything centralized and having this coordinator type role supporting patients and their families be really key, I think.
Okay, very good. Well, guys, listen, we've been 40 minutes here discussing this. We could probably spend another 40 hours or 40 days talking about what we could or couldn't do and what would work and what wouldn't work. I think as certainly us in the field of rare diseases, Lauren, Rachel, and some on the call on this webinar, we know that there is a strategy in development. But we need to try and expedite some pieces to allow this rare disease diagnosis to happen much, much quicker. We can't wait for the full implementation of the strategy. And that's really what we're pushing for now. Can we do something to make a step change in a rare disease diagnosis to move that needle, I guess, from 6.1 years right down? We know that at the moment, a 2-year time frame for consultation with genetics versus something like 12 weeks up in Northern Ireland, that there's opportunities for step changes to happen here today or in the short term that would really benefit all of us and build a better foundation for implementation of the strategy over the years ahead. But without further ado, I would like to thank Laura for sharing your story and wish both you and Alana and the rest of the family much happiness in the years ahead. I have met Alana and she is a great lady. And Dr. Crowley, Rachel, thank you so much for sharing some of your experience. This is the first of our Get Rare Aware webinars. We will have more over the coming months. I guess covering the different geographical regions of the country as they're about to be defined under Sláinte Care. So we're trying to be a little bit ahead of the posse, but our next meeting is towards the end of April. I think it's the week of the 20th of April. And I, off the top of my head, I can't remember what RHA is. But anyway, we will get all of that information out. But if you do want to know more about the whole campaign, then we have a website, getrareaware.ie. And on that website, for those of you living with rare diseases or those of you in the community, generally speaking, there's an opportunity there to send emails to your elected representatives and to ask them to get Rare Aware, to let's push this message and get the government to deliver on their promise in the programme for government for more support for Crumlin genetics, because it will only help all of us. Additionally, on the RDI website, there is the list of dates, and there will be links up there over the coming weeks of the further webinars coming end of April through to the middle of June. So listen, thank you all very much for turning up today. Thank you very much for your time. I hope that you have learned something useful. And we really do look forward to this campaign, I guess, moving things forward for all of us. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you.